Currently, there are a lot of confusions about nationalism. So, as I understand, the nationalism comes up with the freedom movement, and the three major representatives of Indian nationalism I put as Bhagat Singh, Gandhi and Ambedkar. That may sound a strange combination, but that's how I look at it.
Veteran secular activist, academic, who has been touring the country up and down maybe for the last 20-25 years, giving lectures, trainings in Hindi, English both, on issues particularly of history that are constantly dogging the communal mind and are creating myths and stereotypes. He has published books, he has many videos, he has a YouTube channel. Now, a very interesting thing happened a few days ago. A book authored by him, which is looking at the whole question of communalism and history, the myth-making around history, was suddenly picked up by one of our most notorious channels, Times Now, and a whole 9-minute slot was devoted to 5 or 6 pages from the book. We are specifically having this conversation with Dr. Puniyani to look at why was this picked up, what was the context, and what was the intent of this entire exercise. Dr. Puniyani, the passage that was picked up was about Mahmud Ghaznavi and his raiding of the
Somnath
temple, and the fact that you mentioned that why did he not read other temples on the way. Then Aurangzeb is mentioned. Anyway, that's about, we don't want to give more space to what they said. What do you think was the motive behind the selective use of this book that you published?
See, this book was basically published with the intention of confusions about nationalism. So, as I understand, the nationalism comes up with the freedom movement, and the three major representatives of Indian nationalism I put as Bhagat Singh, Gandhi and Ambedkar. That may sound a strange combination, but that's how I look at it. So, I wanted to explain that this Indian nationalism comes with the values of equality, fraternity and liberty, central points.
And inclusiveness.
And inclusiveness, pluralism. And also two very important phenomena which accompany it are reaching of the education to women, girls and Dalits. So, these five things I see as very important. So, my intention was that people today are getting flown by the whole concept that religion and nationalism are combined. So, that's, I trace the history of Indian colonial period. Then I go on to how people have constructed the nationalism and related them to the religion of the kings, which is the most surprising and funny part, that how kingdoms, religion of the kings, and nationalism is put together. Because fundamentally, kingdoms are a very different form of organization of the state, and nation state is absolutely different. And so that's, I wanted to clarify, and I took up in this book right from beginning to many of the contemporary issues also, like this attack on GNU, then this Rohit Vemula issue, then issues related to contemporary communal politics. So I felt that this book should clarify to people that just taking up the issues of temple, cow beef, love jihad, ghar wapsi, etc., etc., this is not what democracy is all about. Democracy and the nation state, Indian nationalism, which came up, was primarily focused on the issues related to this world, which are concrete, material, and which are also based on the rights of the people. So that was one of my ideas.
Were you surprised when Times Now did this? I mean, they came to you and took a comment as well.
Yeah, they took my comment on WhatsApp. And initially they told me that your book is being used by Congress party for training their cadre. So that gave me two pleasant surprises. Number one, that the book is circulating. And number two, that a party like Congress is training its cadres. Because our main problem is that the Congress party or even many other socialist parties who are well-intentioned, who have secular ethos ingrained into them, have forgotten that your political cadre has to be given the right type of political training. So I spontaneously felt happy that, and that girl who was taking my WhatsApp interview, I said, I'm happy to know that Congress is conducting classes and Congress is using the book. So that's about all.
Was there an attempt to somehow belittle your work and your contribution, which has been decades long, by saying that this is just kind of being used by, or he's a student of the Congress Party. Because that is some, that is a kind of an allegation often used against activists.
Yeah.
And to say that, okay, that the aspect about Muslim rulers or rulers like even Ghaznavi or Aurangzeb is being toned down for its cadres.
Yeah.
Because you yourself said that there were many other portions of the book like Vivekanand and Shivaji. Which have not been, which were not referred to in that 9 minutes of the program.
Yes, I think both things are true. One is that they were trying to say that how dare anybody can say that Mahmud Ghaznavi was not that black as he is projected. So that was the main crux of the program, that this book is trying to exonerate the Muslim atrocious marauders and atrocious rulers and their atrocities. This book is an attempt to whitewash the black deeds of the Muslim kings. That was their tone. And surprisingly, Teesta, what personally surprised me when this anchor was reading about Mahmud Ghaznavi, had he thought for a second, he himself would have been clear that what is being said is totally rational. If Mahmud Ghaznavi had to destroy it for religion or insulting Hindu religion, there are hundreds of temples on the way, which is my common logic. And also that Somnath temple had wealth apart from other factors.
No, and there are two other things about Ghaznavi which I keep using for when I talk to young people. One is that on his way back, he raided Sindh, Multan in Sindh.
Yeah.
And Multan in Sindh was a completely Muslim-dominated town and province.
Yeah.
And also that the Somnath temple had been raided previously by several other Jain, Pallava and other kings because it was the seat of a lot of wealth.
Very correct.
So the motive behind raiding many of these temples and mosques during the medieval times was because they were the seat of people's wealth, because people came and gave a lot of wealth.
So that was one. Secondly, they took up the example of Aurangzeb. And the anchor correctly read what I have written. Aurangzeb gave donations to the Hindu temples. Now when he's saying this, why he's not thinking for a minute that same Aurangzeb destroys one temple and same Aurangzeb is giving donation to the temples. So he's reading it, but he's not thinking it. Because I think he has a predetermined mind that if something good is said about Muslim kings, that should not be accepted. And that will be a wrong way to whitewash. Actually, the words they used on the program on the backside, what the slogans come up, that attempt to whitewash Muslim kings, attempt to give them clean chit, as if we are judges sitting on their crimes or
no,
good
I
or
think
bad.
What the anchor was also doing, because I watched the program, I think what the anchor is also trying to do is play to the discourse that is being legitimized today by the political class. So I think the party in power today wants this kind of discourse to be legitimized.
Yes.
So, commercial television, I don't call it national television.
Yes.
Commercial television today is actually pandering to this dominant discourse because they feel that will help them curry favor with the party in power.
I fully agree with you because had they even, because that a girl who took my interview on WhatsApp, she had access to the book. And I am sure if had she turned few pages of the book and seen the whole
This is the book, right?
And seen the whole sequence.
Yeah.
In this book, again, I come in a very logical, according to me. Of course, everybody thinks they are logical. So I begin with kingdoms and freedom movement, then secularism concept and post-independence communalism. So the way it flows, it also takes the politics of RSS and pluralist legacy of Jawaharlal Nehru. There, actually in the appendix, I have put one chapter which had those times now people seeing. Probably they should have felt that the logic of the book is something different than what they are trying to present. Because the whole pluralist legacy of medieval times is given in similar small detail. But I think they didn't bother to see that. Of course, apart from that, I did raise the issue of resurgence of Gandhi assassin Godse's worship. Then how intolerance is going up due to sectarianism. I also take up this issue of cow beef. And in this cow beef chapter, interestingly, I quote Vivekanand, that Vedic period we had consumption of beef. And then I quote Gandhi, despite he says, I want to serve cow, but people should have their own choices and all that. So all that I see. So what is surprising to me, the way these commercial television, as you correctly put it, how much bias they are. Now, one book has come to them. They want to criticize it. Most welcome. But at least what is the central theme of the book, how it flows.
This selective picking up of a passage.
Correct.
And just running that again and again seems to be
correct.
Programmed to something else.
Yes. And the main program was to say that Congress is now trying to counter RSS by presenting Muslim kings in a good light, which Congress will never do. I'm very sure about it.
Yeah.
Or Congress or any other party, if they have to combat RSS, the basic point of
combating is religion-based nationalism.
Religion-based nationalism.
Regardless of where it comes from.
Exactly. And that's where I think I put Bhagat Singh, Ambedkar and Gandhi streams.
On a different plane.
Despite their differences.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How common agenda they had. Mm-hmm. And then again, I take up this Nehru also slightly in detail. Because the book is very small. It is meant for an average reader. So I do take up how Nehru took the policies, which laid very solid foundation. Secularism is a word, but in practice, what he did for all these modern institutions, education and irrigation, there may be...
Even setting up your IITs.
Yes, he did everything he did can be criticized.
Yeah, yeah.
But the basic thing, the direction which he took, like one example which I should have given here was, which later on I formulated, was again this reconstruction of Somnath Temple.
Yeah.
When the issue came up, Gandhi said, Hindu community is capable of making its own temple.
Yeah.
And Nehru went on to say, this is not what
the state should,
do. And he demonstrated it, what state should do, by building another type of temples, which I call university.
Jawaharlal Nehru University.
Universities, industries, irrigation system, and whole lot of things which gave us the foundation to stand up as a nation in the contemporary complicated world. That is where I try to take it up also.
Are you worried about the growth of a physical threat because of this kind of attack on television? Because that could be one of the intents. You had this threat coming up in the month of June, and after which you were given protection and all of that. And you are kind of traveling all across the country, and we are seeing the kind of intolerance that is being unleashed.
Yeah.
Do you feel that this can also be seen as an attempt to whip up hatred against you?
Honestly, I have not given much of a thought to that. What thought came to my mind that how much biased today's society has become. That even if you put the things most logically in their correct concept, they are not willing to go through any other thing. So they are reading the passage, and the meaning of the passage is fairly different
from what it is intended to be.
What they try to say. So that's, I'm more worried about that. Personal security wise, I have not thought much, so I won't comment.
So it is the selective picking up of a passage, decontextualizing it, and then make it an object of a 9-minute program on commercial television at news hour that unfortunately many of our channels are doing. Finally, what do you feel should really be done about the political re-education of this country? Because this is part of that process, but I think we are all trying in our own ways, but we are being able to play such a limited role.
See, I think, Teesta, this is the million rupee question to me. And I feel the present impasse in which we are, and that education is needed at two levels. One is that what Gandhi and then partly Nehru did, through their actions, they were educating the masses.
Yeah.
And through another process, through Congress Seva Dal and through actually our comrades, though of course they have become very weak currently, they were having their own classes but not contextualizing the Indian situation. So I feel that unless we have a large number of young friends who are able to whom we can communicate the basic meaning of Indian nationalism, pluralism, diversity,
constitution,
and of course the Indian nationalism, whole freedom movement leads to constitution.
Yeah.
And constitution is a culmination of all those debates and things like that. So I personally am convinced that unless we can strengthen this reaching of these values to our new generation, we cannot combat communalism in the honest sense. That's my real thought. I feel sometimes pessimistic also that whatever we are doing is not, we are not very successful in that. Somewhere we need to introspect that what we are doing and how best we can ensure that these values of Indian nationalism, Indian constitution are reached to the masses in their own language. Because here is the beauty of Gandhi's teaching, that how he could communicate the things.
Simplicity of language.
Simplicity and his actions and his whole life, how he could communicate that it really reached the people, it changed their mindset. Actually, today, in hindsight, I feel that Gandhi really shook the nation's conscience and people's thinking in a very deep way, much more gross way. And what we are seeing is just trying to undo the process by through some other type of trainings, which are going more consistently. The problem is we can criticize others, but the people, those who are opposed to these values of pluralism, diversity, they have worked much more sincerely, much more hard, much more consistently. So probably to counter, to bring it back to the ethos of Indian nationalism, a lot of training program needs to be undertaken, and this has to be multi-layered.
I think the real weakness on quote unquote our side is not so much the content or not so much the approach, or even the dedication, but organization. I think we just don't understand how the value of an organization. I saw this in Gujarat 2002 as well. It's not so much the number of people, but it is the sheer vicious, meticulous organization that went into certain kind of acts that make them successful. You can't have well-meaning, disparate individuals and groups doing something that can happen with military precision. And we have an organization that will turn 100 years in about 5 years, 6 years' time. And that organization today says that it represents all of India.
So that I must say I fully agree with you. We do need a broader platform, which is organization. We need not merge our identity into it, but our coordination as a proper platform, supplementing each other, strengthening each other, and standing in solidarity with each other, I think is the key. I fully agree with you. That is the key for our next steps in case we want to save the democracy and Indian constitution.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Teesta. Thank you.